Thank you very much. I really am honored to be here. I don't think that I'm giving a keynote address. We are just having a conversation about the issues that we think are critical for you to look at and send them back to us in a much more refined way. So I want to take this opportunity to thank the program director who's driving this program today, the Honorable MEC Somyo of Economic Development, Environment and Tourism in the province of the Eastern Cape, our Deputy Executive Mayor Babu Phakathi in the Buffalo City Municipality, our professors, and in particular Professor Hartzenberg, and other academics that are here with us today, the researchers and other intellectuals that are invited in our midst, delegates, distinguished guests, and ladies and gentlemen. I think, as said, this is an inaugural conference to provide an opportunity for both public policymakers and academics to reignite the discourse on the effective implementation of the industrial policy and sharing the insight that are insights that are premised on the evidence-based research that put on economic growth, productivity, employment, thus leading to economic regeneration of South Africa and the rest of the continent. Wim Naudi and Adam Smy and others, in their research, in their studies on industrialization lessons, especially from the BRICS countries, the study that is titled Comparative Analysis, they state that technological progress and its diffusion were important for the first industrial revolution in Britain in the 18th century. It was also vital for the second revolution of industrialization of the continental Europe and the USA in the 19th century, and for the third revolution industrialization of Japan and the East Asian and newly industrializing economies of the 20th century. In each of the cases, catch-up resulted from lagging countries accessing technology developed in leading nations, adapting it effectively to local circumstances, and subsequently relying more on indigenous innovation. Technology has become more important as ever. In the current modular and flexible production system that has come to characterize a world economy. At the heart of these epochs of industrial revolution in various parts of the world was a clear intervention by the state in partnership with all social partners in terms of the social compact to drive the industrial development agenda with a set of industrial policy that embraced research and development, innovation that were well supported, as well as well-supported entrepreneurs. International literature on economic and industrial development shows that countries that remain focused only on extractive industries and primary agriculture commodity have dismally failed to develop their value chain, with severe economic imbalances felt in society, characterized by lack of economic inclusion with benefit bias towards the few. In contrast, countries such as East Asia that have embraced research and development, including innovation, in their beneficiation effort, have had a sustained growth and increased benefit to broader society. The 21st century represents a window of opportunity where South Africa and the rest of the continent should carve their economic niche and their pioneers, and to be pioneers in the reindustrialization of South Africa's economy. The postmodern age requires forging of strong relationship between public policymakers and academia. Such relationship are key and must must be at the core of industrial planning and support, and this must be counted as a fundamental part of successful growing the country's economy. And in particular, you know that in South Africa we're spearheading the IPEP as advocated by the government. This collective comprising of government and academia need to actively engage in the process of searching and identifying suitable related development models for reindustrialization and economic growth. The current epoch of our quest to reindustrialize and make substantial value addition to our raw material require a dynamic innovation and a creative African researcher who understand that our quest for economic transformation is premised on socio-economic justice. This generation of African researcher must understand that inclusive growth and development is critical in our march towards achieving the objective of the National Democratic Revolution. Acknowledging that South Africa and the continent's economy has been premised on the supply of raw materials without a value addition, the fundamental transformation of the mineral energy complex and changing the current agrarian structure of production should preoccupy researchers and delegates of this conference. This pioneering collective should lead the charge in trying to provide innovative ideas of the 21st century in industrializing our economy, such as ours here in South Africa. As we know that the postmodern age has been characterized by a consistent call for change in the industrial production paradigm. And this happened at a time when Africa's economic development is on the gradual rise. This imminent development in the continent represents an opportunity for this pioneering generation of academics and researchers, in particular here in South Africa and in the continent. The fundamental challenge of every developing country like South Africa is how it mobilizes its resources in a way that brings structural changes necessary to stimulate a sustainable and balanced growth for the entire economy and effective economic redistribution. Sectors such as agriculture, manufacturing, ICT, energy, and especially electricity have become essential to the modern technological system, and it has shaped the contemporary development patterns. This influence determines many aspects of our social development. There is a thread that connects all these fundamental aspects and characteristics that define the new African academic and researcher, and that it is ability to remain hungry and continuously search for scientific answers and innovation for the benefit of the continent and of mankind in general. This resolve a commitment in an embodiment of aspiration of people of the continent. The threat is that the legitimacy the African researcher must enjoy amongst his peer is further afield. As the ANC-led government, it is our view that South Africa and the continent's economic development and growth primarily lies in the hands of our researchers and academics. This is a collective that should lead Africa's renewal and chart a new developmental paradigm. South Africa and Africa's development path, as led by this collective of sharp minds, should be premised on the ethos of inclusivity as we intensify our efforts towards reindustrialization of South Africa and the continent. The significance of manufacturing sector in South Africa cannot be ignored. Redevelopment of the abandoned economic centers, especially in the manufacturing sectors, need to be prioritized in order to stimulate the country's economic growth and achieve the National Development Plan as set out in our NDP. As we share the insight on our respective research output in the forthcoming parallel sessions, continuous research output and innovation in addressing the current challenges that are bedeviling some of our critical sectors that could leverage higher levels of growth and economic activity in our country will be under discussion between delegates and the respective presenters. Ladies and gentlemen, fundamental transformation of the mineral energy complex as born out of the apartheid space economy and changing current agrarian structure of production should be at the core of our economic discourse as we continue to engage. As we start this inaugural ERAN conference, it is imperative to appreciate that since the advent of democracy in 1994, South Africa's reindustrialization posture has always been anchored on the tenets of industrial development planning and support. The ANC-led government has acknowledged that the significance of industrial planning and support as a necessary tool to re-engineer and develop a new inclusive path which will take South Africa on economic development trajectory that is able to respond to the challenges and opportunities of industrialization economy of the 21st century. Tim Voley and John Nels, in their papers on innovation policy as industrial policy, state that the widespread transformation of economic base has seen the decline of traditional manufacturing economies and the rise of knowledge-based economies. Consequently, conventional manufacturing-oriented industrial policy has become the future-oriented towards the challenging of knowledge-based economies. I want to take this opportunity to say that as you continue interacting as intellectuals and academia, you just have to be mindful that the government, given the current economic conditions, have taken the view that we'll focus on the six economic pillars as we begin to respond to some of the challenges that are confronting us. That which we normally refer to as the six I's. We have sought to say that it is important for us to industrialize our economy. In that, we have already come up with the industrial policy action plan that focuses firstly on manufacturing and secondly on agriculture and as well as the IPEP for the mineral sector. So this is one area that we are doing a lot of work to try and bring about innovation around issues of industrialization. And the second focus of government is around the infrastructure, where we've said that these represent the growth stimulus and access, not just only in the continent, but also broader in the continent. So the issue of infrastructure development has become an anchor for economic development in the midst of the challenges that we face as a country. And the third area, which we are doing, but we might not be doing that well, is around issues of investment, where foreign direct investment and local savings should come to the fore to support industrial development in South Africa. And we think that more work must be done around that particular area. And the fourth area is around innovation, where we think you can play a major role as academia and intellectuals to generate new research and development that will lead into new product prototypes and so on, so that we can ensure that we keep up with economic development of our area. And the fifth area of our focus as government is around the issues of inclusion. You know that the BEE, if not revisited through the codes that have been passed, including new initiatives like the Black Industrialist Program, we are going to leave majority of our people who mainly are black on the sideline of the economy, which would not augur well with what is happening, because you will know that the ANC-led government over the past 21 years has been the buffer between the rich and poor. So it can no longer continue. We want to make sure that we bring as many black qualifying people as possible into the mainstream economy in order to ensure that we have a united South Africa that we seek to build as the ANC-led government. And the last issue of focus on government is around the issue of integration. We have sought to accept now that the development of our country is linked to the development of the continent. So therefore, our government is leading in the regional integration. You will know that we've already signed the tripartite free trade agreement between the East African Community, COMESA, and SADC as a starting point. And the leadership of President Jacob Zuma is now leading the continental free trade era discussion to create new markets for the things that we ought to be doing as a nation. I am saying these things so that we don't come to conferences like this to put a challenge to our intellectuals and academia without explaining ourselves what exactly are we doing as government beyond just projects of government that seeks to make a contribution in the broader things that we are doing. So we want to take this opportunity, ladies and gentlemen, to call upon our intelligentsia to use their analytical skills to assist government and their country to develop. We know that there are some amongst yourselves who have sought to use their intellectual capacity to undermine government and its effort. They have degenerated to only being critics of government without coming up with solutions. If you read Sunday newspapers and any other publications, you will see that we are a country that is not focused on development. So we thought that on occasions like this, we must use this occasion to basically begin to say to intellectuals, time has come for us to work together for the development of our country, because challenges that are confronting us here are not just out of our own making as this democratic government, but are of global nature, and we need all our people and our citizens, intellectuals, academics, and everybody to make a contribution in order for us to be able to move forward. We know, all of us, as a matter of fact, that developed countries such as China, Japan, and the USA, they use their intellectuals to shape the future of their country. We're asking ourselves, what is it that we have so many intellectuals and academia and researchers amongst ourselves, but they are unable to make a contribution in their own right? Now, there is a current debate of whether or not our country is sliding into the junk status. And this is what has recently occupied the public discourse. I don't think that we have spent more time asking ourselves collectively as a nation, what is it that we can do collectively to look for alternative given the current economic conditions, which are global in nature. We want to say that opportunities like this conference provide us that opportunity in our own spare time to really engage beyond that which is in the public discourse about where we want to move forward. The fact is that we are experiencing drought that affects our agricultural sector currently. And the fact is that, secondly, that we have low commodity prices that are affecting our mineral sector. And the fact is that the electricity challenges that we are resolving now as government is another challenge that is affecting our manufacturing sector. And the list goes on. But I'm counting these as three main sectors that have been the pillar of our economic development in South Africa, that in all of them, we are facing different challenges. The issue is, what are we doing as an alternative to this in the short term? So as government, I've already spoken to you about the Six Eyes initiative, which has become a strategy that we are championing. But over and above that, in the short term, we are now looking at the services sector, including sectors such as the film, the ICT, finance, retail, and tourism, while we are working on all these macro fundamentals that we are here to correct today. Because we think that the future of South Africa lies in the industrialization as a whole. But we cannot sit back and do nothing as a country when we have these challenges. We are saying this because we have made an assessment and we've come to the conclusion that, yes, we're a community-based economy, but we're experiencing global turmoil, which requires our intelligentsia to critically interrogate the trend and say, what is it that we can do in the short term to ensure that we can ensure economic development? Because at all times, we must ask ourselves, what is our contribution to solving the triple challenges of poverty, unemployment, and inequality that continues to persist. This is the struggle that we want to wage with yourselves. And lastly, Program Director, all spheres of government in our assessment generally is that we are losing skilled human resources, and this is a worrying trend. You have all the intelligent and intelligentsia and the researchers who are outside of the public sector. And we think that this is a danger to the developmental agenda of the state. We know that there are some amongst us who still remain, but would want to make this call very firmly that we have to make a contribution to national service. It can't be that the only actuarial science that we have at the helm of the state is the statistician general and no one else. What will happen after him? And so on. And the list goes on in other sectors. So we thought that on occasions like this, we must make the call that intellectuals, researchers, and intelligentsia must find their way back to the state in order to ensure that we can build capacity to move our country forward. Public sector, as you know it, is very important in all of your aspect of life. When you are born, when you get married, when you die, when you travel abroad, when you do anything, including getting your own academic qualifications, the state is there. So it can't be that this thing that is so important, you run away from it immediately after you've done all those things. And we want to make this call that our intellectuals must come back. And we're making this point, noting that we have a number of intellectuals and academia and researchers who have subsequently became researchers with private interest. And their interest is not consistent with the National Development Plan. Their interest is to make quick bucks and possibly even leave the country. So that is why we're making this call that if we want to be a nation of Nelson Mandela, as we have said, the nation that is hopeful, the nation that will develop, will need to go back to basics. In conclusion, we must know that without increasing participation of research and development, especially amongst the that is crafted by academia in various iterations of the industrial policy in South Africa, our people will forever toil in poverty and underdevelopment. And this is the reason why we thought that initiatives like this conference are critical. We hope that we'll have a debate of substance other than a debate of sorting to just criticize the state where we're not doing right. We want scientific evidence of the things that must change because radical transformation must happen in order to ensure that we're able to move forward. Thank you very much, Program Director.